this day is presented by Salvation Farms and in part with Farm to Plate and Vermont Sustainable Jobs Fund. We're sponsored by Skinny Pancake and Heavier Cake Catering has provided the snacks and lunch. Really grateful also for Main Street Landing for the space and the support from the Vermont Agency of Agriculture, Food and Markets for helping to put this on again today. So just to frame the day a little bit, today we've tried to invite a whole array of food system players and partners and collaborators. We have representatives from schools, corrections, hospitals, state agencies, nonprofits, farms and farmers, and then some just general supporters and friends of the organization. So Salvation Farms, one of the things that really drew me to the organization is that we've always sought really collaborative relationships. We have no interest in trying to do this work alone. That's impossible, as we all know. So we've really looked to build and strengthen and reassess and alter our relationships to make the best food system that we can in Vermont. I think that's what we're all trying to do here. So Salvation Farms is really especially committed over the next few years to draw on colleagues that have such a diversity of skills and experiences. We have a certain set that we're really proud of, and everybody else in this room has a different set that's equally needed and vital to come together in spaces like these and other events to collaborate really successfully and to utilize the precious resource of farms and food and the agricultural space in the state that other states can't boast about. So what we're hoping to achieve from today, in the past, Salvation Farms has collaborated both formally and really informally with a lot of you all and a lot of other players, but we're really hoping that today will kind of be a spark for a true statewide collaboration and really examining this question of what do we do with all this extra food. So a few kind of ground rules. We've all heard these before, but I'm sort of new to this work. You all have been doing this for a while, and we all sometimes bring our own baggage or our own, you know, perspectives to these sort of conversations. So we just ask everyone here to really speak from your own perspective and not to speak on behalf of others, to really stay in a place of curiosity and learning and seeking to understand something new today. We ask that you avoid making generalizations, that you be mindful of your intent in your language and your speech, and account for the impact that your speech might have on others, and to please don't interrupt or speak over others. And then I was talking with somebody last night actually about this concept of challenge by choice. So if you tend to be really talkative in group sessions or dominate, if you have that personality, try to challenge yourself to step back and maybe not play that role. And if you tend to stay quieter in groups and sit back, challenge yourself of what needs to be said in the group that isn't being said, what is important for you to share. So with that, we're really excited to have you all here today. Thank you again for coming. I have the pleasure of introducing Deputy Secretary Alyson Eastman. She's agreed to come and give a few remarks to open the day. She was appointed the Deputy Secretary of Agency of Agriculture, Food and Markets by Governor Phil Scott this January. Alyson Eastman was born and raised in Vermont, has a really kind of rich agricultural heritage in her upbringing and the areas in which she's chosen to enrich her life. Farming's a big part of her heritage. She received her college education here in Vermont, obviously really committed to this state, serving her community through things like the supervisory unions and school boards. Salvation Farms has really valued her interest in our work and your enthusiasm in your past as a legislator of really hearing, staying updated on kind of what we're doing. Really happy to have you here with us today, so welcome.
Thank you, Julie. That's a great introduction. As she said, I served in the legislature, and I think my first time meeting Theresa was 2 years ago. And her testimony moved me to many levels about this conversation. I had never really thought about surplus crops before, other than going to farms and seeing the seconds in the bucket getting ready to hit the compost pile. And I thought to myself, what a shame. Something doesn't look good and it can't hit the market, but it's certainly able to be consumed. So I'm very moved to be at what I believe is the first Vermont Surplus Crop Forum. Maybe we'll make this an annual existence. I'd like to point out too that we have agency staff here today. We have Alyssa. Alyssa's over here. We have Allie. Allie's hiding over there. And where's Abby? Thank you, Abby. So they will be staying here throughout the day. And they're very excited in the work they do, which makes jobs like mine easy. I regret that I will not be able to spend the full day with you. Our legislature is still in session, and so I will be going back to handle some bills that are in motion that pertain to the agency. However, I do believe the Secretary of Ag will be stopping in this afternoon to listen in. So it's exciting and important to see how ag continues to be diversified and that people are actually moving to this state and they have an experience or wish to experience agriculture and staying here. They want to work the land, feed their community, and be a successful business. Fruit and vegetable production continues to expand and is joining in the ranks amongst Vermont's milk and maple state. At a time when more consumers are demanding access to local food. Very good. In 2012, NOFA Vermont Institutional Demand Research identified an opportunity gap of more than $10 million spent by institutions on non-local fresh foods. Quite an opportunity there. Vermont farmers want to sell to their communities and beyond to regional markets. We have resourceful producers in Vermont who want to be successful businesses, but also want to serve their community and ensure neighbors have access to fresh, healthy, local foods. Champlain Orchards is a prime example of an operation that reduces on-farm food loss by their value-added production of seconds. I commend Salvation Farms for collecting the food loss data, pairing it with farm institution demand, and the great enthusiasm to bring together interested stakeholders to tackle this issue. Salvation Farms' recent on-farm food loss study results estimates 14.3 million pounds of edible vegetables and berries remain underutilized on Vermont farms every year. Today's conversation and brainstorms will be around how farmers can utilize harvested but slightly irregular, unwashed, and otherwise compromised products to serve the growing demand by institutions for local, fresh, and whole product. The questions that remain, can we find a way for producers to access a viable market with these products? Can institutions commit to purchasing products in replacement of the non-local items? Do we have the right people in the room to determine how to incorporate surplus crops into our institutional meal programs? And can this process be a win-win for Vermont's food systems? This work feels like the perfect fit with farm-to-plate goals of increasing local consumption, expanding institutional consumption of local products, and making local food more available to Vermonters. If we can move lost product off the farm to a demanding market, that is no doubt a success. These concepts are aligned with the governor and our Agency of Ag priorities to serve the most vulnerable, strengthen our local economy, and make Vermont more affordable. Let's creatively explore more approaches to meeting our state's food needs through not only increasing the production on our state farms, but also utilizing the food resources existing on Vermont farms that don't currently make it into the marketplace or to the consumers. This is an exciting opportunity to come together and explore collaborative solutions to move forward surplus food for institutional markets. It can be a win-win for Vermont producers, our institutional markets, and our local consumers. Thank you for your time and coming out today. It's great to see so many interested in this conversation. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. So thanks. You all have been thanked several times for being here. And thank you, Deputy Secretary, and really for acknowledging the importance of this conversation, and to your staff, and to Farm to Plate, to all of you. It's really an honor to have this day happen, and I feel like it's been a long time coming. Go ahead, Julia. So you've heard a little bit about the food loss numbers. So we did a study last year that surveyed just over 50 farmers across the state. And based on their responses, it's estimated the average estimate is 14.3 million pounds of surplus crops. That's vegetables and berries stay on Vermont farms each year. What does 14 million pounds look like? Well, you can fit 1 ton of roots into a pickup truck. So if you put 14 million pounds into pickup trucks, and if they were all root crops, it would be 7,000 pickup trucks lined up. That's a line of trucks 26 miles long. And for those of you that drive Interstate 89, that line of trucks extends from the Waterbury exit to the Burlington exit. And that's about how much food we leave on Vermont farms every year. So what is food loss? So it's that food which is considered wholesome and edible, but neither harvested, or it's harvested but it's not sold or donated. So it is a lost food resource that really isn't wasted, because farmers will feed it to animals or feed it to their soil and it'll become food again. But it is a lost resource for human consumption. Out of the 14.3 million pounds, that number, 4% is berries, 96% is vegetables. And I think the pretty incredible number that has stunned much of us is that 68% of that 14.3 million is already harvested. And that's kind of the volume of crops we're going to be looking at today. And if the farmer has already put the labor into getting this food out of the field, how come it's not moving off of the farm? Actually, could you go back, Julia? And this number just represents the typical estimate of how much of total vegetables or total berries grown in the state is left on farms. So the average is about 15% of all produce produced never makes it off the farm. So our food loss study certainly has its limitations. We do have some conclusions. Limitations was that there were no tree fruit growers who responded. So therefore, that's a big chunk of producers that we don't have data on. Also, it was survey, data collection. What we could do is extend this research for a number of years where we have on-farm observations happening with farmers that have different diversities, different markets, different scales of production, and we could ask them to track really critically what's going on with their markets, what's going on with their labor, what's going on with the climate, with weather, and how that's implicating or impacting what they produce, harvest, and sell. So while there were limitations, it's still a really compelling number, and it's a great place to start from. And our study is the first statewide attempt to quantify food loss on farms in the nation. It's been done in a few other areas, very specific regionally, with very targeted questions, as opposed to wanting to just find out why and what. So our conclusion was that a robust food loss management plan needs to be created that has the farmer at its core. It needs to expand market opportunities for farmers. It needs to compensate farmers. And that support for farm surplus management operations need to be strengthened in a way, or need to be supported in a way that strengthens the farms in the regional food system. So I want to kind of step back. And what I'm doing is trying to frame the issue for you. So maximizing farm resources is a pretty new topic, globally, nationally, not for Salvation Farms, not here in Vermont. FoodWise is a Rockefeller Foundation initiative. It's based in Africa. And what they're trying to do is reduce post-harvest losses on farms. ReFed produced a report last year, this is national, where 16% of all food wasted in America happens on the farm. That's 10 million tons of produce. The Natural Resource Defense Council is the other entity in this country that has done food loss studies. Their first study was in 2012 with a group of Central California farms to identify why crop shrink exists, why crops are not harvested, and why they're left out of the marketplace. And most recently, which Salvation Farms is really quite excited about, beyond helping refed a little bit in their stakeholder meetings, we have been working with the Harvard Food Law Policy Clinic. We are a co-facilitator of a national working group that focuses on building infrastructure for addressing farm-level surplus in the country. And recently, we have joined the advisory committee for a World Wildlife directed project about maximizing farm resources and increasing edible food rescue. That's in partnership with UC Davis and the Global Cold Chain Alliance. So while we've been doing this work, I've been doing this work since 2004, nationally, globally, people are just catching up with the fact that this is a critical issue that must be addressed. And addressed in such a way that there are global goals of halving food loss in the next 13 years, and nationally reducing it by half in the same time frame. So we also, with our food loss study, you know, finding that 14.3 million pounds that's left on Vermont farms every year, we also did a fresh produce demand study last fall. And what we found mirrors what NOFA Vermont and Vermont Feed found in 2012. A lot of the same barriers, a lot of the same opportunities. So we wanted to certainly give a shout out to them and their research, because theirs is prettier and I feel a little more thorough than ours, although ours did yield some great data. That the 200 plus agencies or sites that answered our surveys consisted of food shelves and schools and prisons and hospitals indicated that they wanted a wide array of produce on a weekly basis. So a great diversity, which I thought was really promising. What we found interesting was that most of them had a preference for near perfect looking food. These are the, this kind of represents the wedge that, you know, they don't really mind if it doesn't look perfect. The rest kind of care. You know, it takes a lot of time to work with something that's inconsistent, that isn't easy to handle and prep. What we also found interesting and really quite promising is that many of these sites wanted processed foods, frozen foods, canned foods, dehydrated or dried foods. And that shows a promise when some of the barriers both identified in our study and with NOFA study is that labor and infrastructure is an issue. So if you don't want perfect looking food, you don't have the time to prep it, and you don't have the infrastructure to store it, then we should be looking at how we can minimally process to hide the appearance of inferior looking product so that it's easy for places to use. So what are we talking about? You know, what are we talking about today? Probably some of these terms are new to you. When Salvation Farms Incorporated, our mission has the phrase agricultural surplus management. I Googled it, nobody else came up. So this is new terminology for a lot of people. So what is surplus, seconds, crops, or produce? How do we classify that? What is food loss? What is an institutional prepared meal site or program? What is surplus management and market development? These are all things that we're going to talk about today. Surplus seconds crops really for us is that product which could just be first quality, could be produced in abundance and just not have a market because of saturation. Could be an issue that it has it's an inferior quality product, or the condition doesn't allow it to keep through any sort of storage time frame. Food loss, we just went over. Institutional or prepared meal sites, so those are any of those food service organizations, many in the room, or entities that serve a clientele that are dependent on their meal program. Prisons, hospitals, nursing homes, veterans homes and hospitals, or schools. Surplus management is really diverse. You know, it can be Joe's Soups, who buys seconds because he can make a marketable product out of it. It can be gleaning, which is done by coordinating volunteers, harvesting surplus or collecting it, and moving it into the charitable food system. Or it could be something like Salvation Farms is doing at our Winooski program facility, which is aggregating large volumes of surplus, cleaning, packing it, and moving it into the charitable food system. But it can also include purchase from farms and the sale to institutions and even possibly retail markets. But what we're really looking at today is, and I think because the issue is so broad and the opportunities are tremendous, we really need to focus what we're going to discuss today. And so our focus is on market opportunities for surplus management that benefits our farms, that serves an institutional demand. So an example why, this is our cooler and our Winooski facility today. We're sitting on more than 9 tons of high quality surplus potatoes that have no home. And you know what these potatoes really want to do? They want to start growing and producing the next generation. Their biological clock is ticking, but right now they could feed a lot of people. Not only this, Julia, we're sitting on 2.5 tons that haven't been packed that also need a home. If we could move this food into institutional meal programs in the state of Vermont, of which we serve up to 19 million annually, who are spending up to $10,000 every year sourcing out of state, it seems like a perfect opportunity. So some basics. There's a lot of work being done by Salvation Farms, our partner organizations in the Vermont Gleaning Collective, the Vermont Food Bank, Willing Hands, the Healthy Harvest Network. There's on this effort on a regional scale, specifically around gleaning, the collection of donated crops for the purpose of charity. So when we think about, well, is the food gonna go through a charitable food stream, or is it gonna go through a market food stream? We need to think about critical things. There's labor laws, there's food liability, and these two pieces, dependent on whether the farm harvested it or whether it was gleaned, really impacts the ability to actually purchase or sell the surplus crop. If it's gleaned, you can't sell the food, because then the farmer's marketing are benefiting from that marketing of their crop, but they were granted free labor. And in the eyes of the federal law, they are avoiding labor payment on tax. That free labor of which they're benefiting from is displacing employment on their farm. So we can't glean and move that food into a market system. If the food is donated, we're covered by the Good Samaritan Act. The farmer's protected food liability, the charitable organization is covered by the Good Samaritan law. Therefore, we can't really sell that food into an institutional market, because that food has to be given in a charitable sense in order for that food liability to maintain its coverage to the farmer and to the charitable organization. So in order to move any surplus to institutions, it has to be purchased. These numbers down here are numbers collected through the Vermont Gleaning Collective, and that's one of Salvation Farms' initiatives that we really won't talk much about today. It's a collection or an association of 6 different gleaning organizations, collecting donated crops from farms, moving into the charitable food system. What we did was we aggregated the data from these 6 different organizations to find out what were the top 4 crops per year that they collected that were already harvested, meaning that they didn't glean them from these farms. These are crops that could have been purchased. These blue lines are potatoes. Carrots. The gray is summer squash. And the yellow is winter squash. So when we think about, well, what could we buy from our farmers and what processes do we need in between the farmer and the eater, these are the crops that we really should be thinking about and that we'll likely be talking about today. So, go ahead, Julia.
On all those potatoes, you can't donate, I mean, don't have a question to answer, but are you going to go into why they're sitting there and you can't move them into, like, to the food bank or?
We send out weekly availability listings to 13 different charitable organizations from Vermont to New Hampshire to Boston, and we're waiting on orders. We do charge a small handling fee, 10 cents on the pound for pickup, 12 cents on the pound if we deliver, meaning if we pay Black River Produce to deliver. So that handling fee, the food is still donated. It covers our cost of providing the cleaning, packing, and trucking. So. So meeting Vermont's nutritional needs. So creating desirable surplus crop products for institutions and prepared meal sites will diversify local sourcing options for the charitable food system too. So I feel and fear that there is a concern that if this product finds market outlets and finds avenues for becoming cleaned and packaged and minimally processed and maybe shelf stable, that there may be a lack of food for those that most need it in our communities, and I don't feel that's a reality. There is so much food out there. We just need to create the infrastructure, the collaborative relationship, so that we can make sure this food is available to both that system and to our institutional meal programs. So these are examples of some of our packaged product at a food shelf, and then some of frozen product that we've made also at a food shelf. Be the same packaging that would go to institutional meal programs or similar. We'd hopefully send bigger packages of potatoes. So I wanted to tell you a little bit about Salvation Farms, but I didn't want to make this a lot about Salvation Farms. Our mission is to build increased resilience in Vermont's food system through agricultural surplus management. I usually like to put context around our work before I tell anyone our mission, because usually our mission then makes no sense. Our goals were driven by three primary goals: reduce food loss on Vermont farms, increase the use of locally grown foods, and to foster a greater appreciation for our state's agricultural heritage and future. We really want to do this for the state of Vermont, for the farms of Vermont, and for the people that eat in Vermont, which is all of us, our families, our friends, our neighbors. I felt it was pretty important to share our purpose because I recently went back to it. One for my staff, another for the board of directors, to think about why did Salvation Farms incorporate? And in 2011, we filed with the Vermont Secretary of State's office this purpose. The corporation will initially engage in creating an agricultural surplus clearinghouse to capture and facilitate the movement of Vermont's agricultural surplus, fruit, vegetables, and meat. Who thought produce would be so tough? So we've been a little delayed on pursuing proteins. But we would facilitate the management or the movement of Vermont's agricultural surplus fruit, vegetables, and meat to make them available to institutions and so well, such as hospitals, schools, correctional facilities, and the general public who are in need of charitable assistance in meeting basic nutritional needs, and developing and educating the public about programs, systems, and policies enhancing and supporting community food security, particularly for members of the general public and institutions in need of assistance to meet basic nutritional needs. So our history, try to do this really brief, because I could do a lot of different ways of our history, my personal history and how I evolved to do this work. I am the founder of Salvation Farms. I was working at Pete's Greens. Pete saw that I was struggling. Although he really enjoyed how hard I worked on his farm, he saw that I needed something more. He asked me, what do I need? What do I want to do? I said, I want to teach people about farms. I want to teach people how important farms are and how critical they are to our communities and how each of us has power to control the inputs for one of our most essential needs, which is to eat. And he says, well, I have a lot of extra greens. And can you do anything with those? I said, sure. I'd been exposed to this concept of gleaning. And I said, I guess I could engage Sterling College students. and we could harvest your surplus, and we could figure out how to move that into our communities without competing with your markets, and create greater community food security through your farm. And so we did that for a number of years. I also worked with the Vermont Food Bank, helping institute their gleaning program and look at their infrastructural needs to manage fresh food, and how their agencies could also receive that food, of which they've continued doing. But it was in 2010 that I decided there needed to be an agriculturally focused and minded organization in the state that wanted to fill a gap, that wanted to do for the farmers what they couldn't do and meet the needs of agencies like the Vermont Food Bank and those that they serve and other institutions that didn't have access to the incredible bounty that sits on our farms every year. So kind of fast forward to today, the reason the Clineal Foundation is on this slide is they're a little bit the enabler of this conversation beyond Farm to Plate and the agency supporting this conversation. We received a critical issue grant. It's a 2-year grant, and this is the first time they have funded any food waste or food loss initiatives. We are the only project that they chose to invite and fund that has to do with food loss on farms because of our leadership in this issue. So one of our deliverables is to facilitate a stakeholder group conversation to develop a Vermont surplus crop management plan. And that's our goal, to start that conversation today, to hopefully continue doing that with Farm to Plate and the great network that exists there, as well as with the support of our legislators and our agency of ag. So an opportunity gap and a value add. What can surplus crop management look like in Vermont? I think it can look like a lot of different things. As far as we have seen, it really is this value add of cleaning, quality assessing, case packing, and minimal processing, of which we've done in our own pilots, of which we've also enabled organizations to receive more fresh foods because they are engaging their communities in the minimal processing and freezing of surplus food. And we are doing it through workforce development training and Vermont's first surplus crop food hub, where we want to diversify into a frozen food line, but really we'd love to get to the point of creating canned and dehydrated foods that really create more resilience in our state's food system. So wanted to frame what some of Salvation Farms' motivators are and what we're striving for. And we strive for impact and we understand the connectivity of systems. I'm a sustainable agriculture student and a natural resource management student. I think ecologically, so I think in systems. I think of levers, I think of reinforcing loops, and I think that every action reinforces things in a positive or negative way. And when I think about what we could do with surplus crops and how that could positively impact our food system in multiple ways, I get really excited. It can affect farm viability, resource management, the food system security and independence in this state. It can really leverage the power of experiential education, and it can invest in Vermont. We can do for Vermont because we have these resources. So very exciting to now have numbers. We did another research project. I just got the numbers yesterday. We engaged some environmental assessment students at UVM. We wanted to find out, when food is left on farms, it's not just the nutrients that remain on the farms and are lost to people, but we lose labor, we lose solar power, we lose fossil fuel, we lose water. We lose all of those things that went into the production of the seed that grows that food. Students said, whoa, you think too big. And they said, why don't we just look into water and fuel? I said, okay. So they found, and I don't have these on the top of my head, so bear with me, that every year approximately 116 million gallons of water are lost in vegetable production in Vermont. 116 million gallons. Now, of course, some of this with more extensive research, we can figure out what is the irrigation practices on our state, on our state's farms. You know, how accurate is this number? But this is based on what the farmers said they lost on their farms. We also are looking at the fuel. Based on that volume of food that farmers reported is lost annually, there's more than 5,000 gallons of gasoline and diesel combined that we lose when that food stays on farms. That's an expense to our state's farmers of more than $20,000 a year. To put that into some context, what the Vermont Gleaning Collective captured last year was around 100, I'm sorry.
I guess the question is, so 5,000, is that per farm?
Yeah. So total lost in fuel, it actually is 2,700 gallons of diesel and 2,600 gallons of diesel, 2,600 gallons of gasoline are lost in production of vegetables. And then 2,600 gallons are lost in berry production.
Across the state?
Mm-hmm. Do you want to see their infographic, their info sheet? We'll make one prettier one, send it out. So those are just some of the things we can quantify. We also are building a nutrient calculator so that we can start to quantify the daily allowances or daily servings of nutrients that we're providing through the crops that we capture and make available. We're getting close on having that tool polished. A lot of interesting data out of that. The other is the economic value of surplus crops. So I started to say that last year, the Vermont Gleaning Collective captured around 180,000 pounds. The market value of those crops was close to $300,000. So I think that's pretty impactful to think some of those programs are running on less than $30,000 a year. And the cost benefit of moving these foods into the system are pretty significant. Go ahead, Julia. So moving a plan forward and strategic action, you know, managing farm surplus is a farm to plate issue. I participated in the day-long summits when the strategic plan was being drafted. I participated in one in Rutland and one in Bennington and one in Brattleboro. And I think that Farm to Plate, or the Vermont Sustainable Jobs Fund, thought I was going on tour. That was while I was also working at the food bank, so I was placed in several different locations within that organization. I sat on a panel when the plan was presented to the legislature. I presented my prediction of food loss on farms at that time, which was a measly 2 million pounds. Among others, I can remember most significantly next to me was Tom Gilbert of Highfields Composting Institute, who was framing the issues of the plan. In 2012, I prepared and provided a statewide budget and structure for gleaning to the Vermont Sustainable Jobs Fund. And in 2014, I and others at Salvation Farms reviewed and offered edits of the food access chapter. We participate in four different working groups as well as cross-cutting teams. And these are the ones we think that most appropriately fit the work that we do. But it is the platform for which this topic can truly be vetted, discussed, and move forward. So meeting many goals, not just our organizations, and I would say least of our organizations, it really should be meeting Vermont's goals to increase local food consumption, increase farm viability, increase an inclusive food system that creates access for all, that improves the quality of our environment and the health of our of our citizens. But I think interestingly enough, it also helps meet other goals. You know, can New England produce 50% of its own food? I'm wondering if New England can consume 50% of its own food. Like, how much are we exporting out? How much are we not eating? And then also the USDA and EPA's goal to reduce food loss and food waste by half in the next 13 years. It's an incredible goal nationally. So this is where we can be a little interactive, and I'm almost wrapping up. So thanks for your patience through the talking portion of the day, the speaking portion. Does anybody know, except for those that already know, who can guess why the farmer did not have a market for these peppers? They're different colors. Yeah. Anybody else have? Yes. Yeah. So the issue was the farmer only has a market for red peppers. And all peppers that are allowed to mature long enough change color. They picked these peppers thinking, well, an impending frost was coming. Maybe I can make the time to find the market for these peppers, which they did not find. Because it's often not economical for a farmer to try to find a new market when they have their markets established. Okay. How about these crops, these carrots?
Size.
Size?
Shape.
Yeah. The farmer actually claimed an insurance loss because they were going to be too small. By the time the claim went through, some of these carrots were this long. Incredible. And because he had claimed the insurance claim and loss, he then could not sell them. Okay. How about these? Who said that?
Farmer.
The farmer. Yes. Yes. Frost. Now, would it be worth, sorry, Julie, if we can go back, would it be worth a farmer's time to go through and pick these for some price on the pound if it was going to be put through a processor? Okay. I usually just like to show this one. So I think this is my last speaking slide. This also came out of our food loss study, when we asked farms what they would like to be provided to their farm. The highest ratings were produce being picked up at their farm, which means it's already harvested. The second one being purchase of produce, followed by gleaning, you know, receiving product donations, so that would be at agencies, transporting produce and down the line. So I just wanted to reiterate the findings, also the kind of conclusion of our initial study, that a plan needs to be devised to expand market opportunities, to compensate farmers, and to support farm surplus management operations that strengthen our state's food system. And thank you for coming. Thank you to our partners and sponsors. We really look forward to the dialogue that's going to happen in this space. We'd love for you all to keep in mind the ground rules that Julia set. Jake will reiterate them. But we want this to be a space that is safe, that is inquisitive, that is a community that's willing to learn and work hard together. So, thanks.